go ahead and get started here. I'm not really used to speaking into a microphone, so I may wander off and you'll have to yell at me and point at the mic again. So my name is Ben Ford. I'm here from Public Labs. I am a PSC, Professional Services, which means that I do a lot of integration work. I go to clients and I work with them and I help them figure out how to use our software to manage whatever it is that they need to manage. The other thing that I do is run training classes. And I've done probably 50 or 60 in the last year. So I talk with small groups of, like small classrooms, small groups of people, walk them through Puppet, teach them what Puppet does, teach them how to use it and everything. So you may find me kind of falling back into the teacher role here, although this is a little bit larger than what our classrooms usually are. So with that, here to talk about using Puppet to manage your server, using Puppet to manage Drupal itself, and using a module that I wrote and pushed out last night to help make this simpler and easier. So, kind of a real quick poll here, a real quick question. How many people out here even know what Drupal or Puppet is? Do we have pretty good size? How many people are using Puppet currently? That's good, a good number of people. So, I hope that I haven't gone too basic with some of the things that I talk about, and if so, that's fine. You know, we'll just move a little bit faster, and we'll have more time for Q&A at the end. Set the scene for my talk today. The audience that I'm really looking to address right now is kind of the small shop, the individual developer, the developer in a larger shop that has to spin up an instance on their dev workstation in order to do testing, do some development, etc. I'm not directly addressing production just yet. This is something that is kind of a short to medium term as far as an advancement of the module. But right now, I want to try and get an idea of what people are looking out of support from Puppet. It seems like a lot of people want to write their own code and manage every single bit that goes out on disk. So this may never get to the point where it's managing production, and it may just serve as a insight for people to write their own code to manage production. We'll see what the interest is. We'll see what people are looking for doing. In the meantime, let's just move forward and we'll talk about what we have right now and maybe we'll talk about some future plans. So, I imagine that many of you are in roles like that where you have to spin up test instances or dev instances, or you have something on your laptop that you're working, maybe a virtual machine or something. So, when you get a new client, when you get a new project that you got going, how do you get started? What is the workflow that you go through? We've got some existing approaches, kind of the default. Just make a new subsite. Use your existing site. It'll work, right? I mean, Drupal's really good at subsites. It's really good at managing multiple sites within one instance. And yeah, most of the time it does work. But not always. And this means that when you get a client, you push out, you get your site built, you get everything pushed to production, and your client says, it's all broken. Nothing works. And now you're starting from scratch, you're debugging, you're saying, well, okay, which version of PHP was it that you're running again? This for every single client. Nobody wants to do that. Nobody wants to be debugging every time. You want to be in a known state. You want to spend the time on what actually builds value for your company. We've got another approach, and that is, okay. we've got another approach, and that is you start from scratch every time. It's safer. You know exactly what goes into this new instance. You spin up a VM. You install Apache. You install PHP. You install everything. You configure everything. And you go. Well, that takes a lot of time. It's also really error prone. I'm sure a lot of you might have seen that. And how many times do you want to be debugging that? Even if it takes you 1 minute to look at this and say, damn it, I forgot it again. If you have 100 clients, you know, if you do this 100 times, that's 100 minutes of wasted. That's 100 minutes lost. If your billing rate is $250 an hour, that's, what is it, $400 lost down the tube. A little bit better of a process might be write your own scripts. And a lot of people do something like this. They have a script that just goes through, and it installs all the packages you need, and it will download Drupal and unpack it, run Drush, and everything. That's quite a good start. But I think we've got something better. You simply run Puppet, and you let Puppet figure out what it needs to do to get you into the state that you've defined. So like I said, my name is Ben. Professional services from Puppet Labs. I'm going to talk to you about how you can use Puppet to kind of accelerate your development, make it more efficient. We'll do a little bit, we'll talk about how Puppet language works. We're not going to go too deep into the code. I think there's a lot more efficient ways for you to learn the language. But we'll talk about the concepts. We'll talk about the things that people have a hard time understanding when they first move to Puppet. And once you understand the model, once you understand how Puppet works, everything else becomes incredibly easy. It's very, very simple to understand how to make Puppet do what you want to do once you have a picture of the model in your head. And then I will introduce the module that I wrote and bring a demo and show the thing working in action. So we like to call Puppet code infrastructure as code, executable documentation, what have you. The point is that this code is immediately readable. I imagine that even the people in here who have never heard of Puppet before, have never seen Puppet code before, can look at this, can read it, and have a pretty decent idea of what's going on. This means that you don't need to have a script that does something that has comments everywhere. Don't forget to update this file. Don't forget to add this user, etc. You don't need to have a wiki that has documentation as well, because as you all know, if you have three different places that you have documentation stored for your site, you're going to have at least four different versions of documentation. So we get to this point. We have our infrastructure as code, executable documentation. There is no wiki, there's no somewhere else that you go to find information out. You read the manifest, you read the description of what your site should look like. And that's it. Puppet works on a declarative model. It's not imperative. You don't get Puppet instructions. Instead, you do something along the lines of drawing a picture. You describe the state that you want. You say that the state that I want this computer to be in is that I want Apache installed. I want PHP configured with this certain setting. I want MySQL installed with a certain database. I want Drupal connected to that database. But you don't have to write a script to do all these things. You step back and you let Puppet figure out what it needs to do. We have a descriptive language that lets you describe the things that the components of this configuration. Every time Puppet runs, it will inspect the state. It will look at the state of the node, and it will decide what this is one of the things that people have a very, very hard time with. They want to, in a sense, write a shell script in public language. Because they're used to that norm, they're used to that idea of, I put some code here, I twiddle some bits there, I run a tool this way. Once you get to the point where you can let Puppet, let the strings work for you, then everything becomes incredibly easy. Everything becomes incredibly simple. You just tell Puppet what you need done, and you let it happen. So when you are spinning up a new machine, this is kind of your workflow. You spin up a machine, you give it to Puppet, already done all the work that needs to be done because you have fully described the state you want the system to be in. You can have multiple versions of this. So you can have client A, client B, client C, etc. And if you want to spin up a machine to run client A's infrastructure, you just tell Puppet, apply this infrastructure. It says I have apache version 5.3, whatever it is that they happen to be running. And it will put the machine in that state. And then if you allow Puppet to run as a daemon and you continue to allow it to maintain the system, that's all it does is it will continue looping over this assigned role and bring the noted conversions with that role. Any drift from that might be changes. Somebody might have made changes, or there might have been some sort of update to the role, or it might be that the machine is freshly installed, there's nothing on it to begin with. Whatever it is, whatever its current state is, Puppet will do what needs to be done in order to put it in the state that you want it. So in order for this to work, we need to understand what resources are. Puppet resources are unit of configuration. The smallest piece of configuration that Puppet knows about. It might be a file, might be a package, might be a service, a user, a host record. All of these things are abstracted away. You can interact with them all the same way. So you can ensure that a file is present just the same as you can ensure that a user is present. You combine them together, and they make larger components. And then you can use those components to kind of stack together to make roles and profiles so that you can get to the point where you say a certain node consists of the classes of SSH and Apache and Drupal, and that is what that node is. Each one of these resources is abstracted away from the operating system, so you don't even need to know whether they're running apt or yum, or whether they're using launchd or this Red Hat services subsystem. Each one of these resource types is interacted with in much the same way, but each one of these resource types has providers that it can choose from. So if you instantiate a package resource on a Red Hat system, it will call out to RPM yum. If you instantiate that exact same manifest with that exact same package resource on a Debian system, it will use apt dpackage. Puppet runs on a huge variety of operating systems, everywhere from many, many flavors of Linux to OS X to Windows, to AIX, if any of you guys are still running that kind of data. And all of these resources work the same way on all of the supported platforms. So the classes that I mentioned, they look a little bit like this. Each class is just a collection of resources. So you can describe an SSH node as saying, every node that has SSH must have the SSH package installed. It must have the SSHD config file in place. service SSHD running, but that gets really tedious. So we write that inside of a class. Now you can say that node must have SSH, and that's it. All of this gets pulled in with it. Modules, again, just like classes are containers for resources, modules are containers for everything having to do with any given configuration. So if you are managing MySQL, you would make a module called MySQL, and you would put everything to do with MySQL in there. You may have files, you may have templates, you may have tools that run, you may have functions. If you're managing Drupal, you might have an SQL dump if you wanted to be naive about how you instantiated the database. But everything to do with any given configuration gets put into one directory. And it has a certain directory structure. And if you follow this directory structure, the naming conventions, it allows you to simply, it allows this module to be relocatable. You can pick it up, and you can move it and put it somewhere else. You can zip it up and share it with a friend, and they can put it on their module path and it will just work. Or you can put it up on the public forge. This is a community site that allows people to share modules, to share code. We'll look at that a little bit later on. That is how I am distributing the module that I've been talking about. Once you have these modules and classes defined, you simply choose to include them on a node. This example has a node, oscar.example.com, that is some sort of web application. Other than that, we can't really tell from this description here. The actual details are much, much deeper. But that's okay, because we write these abstractions. We know that on our infrastructure, anytime you instantiate SSH, you get this class here. So anytime somebody says include SSH, that is what they get. If you make a change on a node, if you remove a package, or if you go in and you fiddle with the SSH deconfig, or stop the service or anything else, Puppet notices that there's a difference, and it will revert them, so it will put those back, so that the state of that node exactly reflects what you have put in the module. Now we're at the state where our nodes become stackable configurations. Instead of writing scripts to configure our nodes, instead of writing long tools and steps to take, some kind of manual process where you have to run a certain script, we simply describe our nodes as blocks, Legos, if you will. This node consists of SSH, Apache, MySQL, and my web app. You can describe your whole infrastructure like this very, very simply, very easily. This diagram here is a JProxy load balancing pool. We've got a node that includes SSH and the proxy. We've got some web nodes that include SSH, Apache, and are members of the pool. And we have a database behind them. And their entire configuration is contained in this very short list of classes. I'm not going to go too deep into the language itself. I am available for questions if when we get to the end of my talk, if you have questions about how any of this works, feel free to ask me, and we can go as deep as you have time to listen. But you should take a note of these resources here. We have a tutorial that is up on our website that is incredibly easy to go through, and it is very, very complete. You go through this tutorial, and it will get you from zero to very good Puppet in a short time. We also have the training classes that I talked about. If you go to our website /training, you'll see the classes described, and you will see when they come in. You may ask your company to sponsor a training session if you are interested in that, and we can schedule something with your company if it's something. there's a lot to a Drupal site. You have a lot of services running. You need a web server. You need a database, some sort of database. You may have a load balancer, Memcache, whatever. You've got a lot of packages to install. You've got all your services and all your dependencies. You've got PHP. You've got any of the extensions. I mean, how many times have you gone through and built a site app that forgot to install PHP GD? You've got Drupal itself, and then you've also got crash. Everybody's running crash. Then you've got configuration. You've got a bunch of files you've got to put in the directory. You've got the settings files for each one of your sites. You've got configuration, PHP, INI, bump up your memory. That's a lot to do. It's a lot to remember. But don't reinvent the wheel. Like I said, we've got the forge. This is made for sharing the community code. Nearly all of this is already done for you. You want Apache up and running, you want to be able to manage, include public labs Apache, and it will do that for you. You want to manage a database, you want to install MySQL, instantiate a database with a certain user. Public labs MySQL module will do that for you. So you don't have to do most of this. You simply have to pull together the pieces and stack them up to make your configuration. I have a module that I wrote. I released yesterday, last night. It is up on the module, up on the forge, so you can install it today. You can use it today. It enables management of Drupal itself, and it also manages subsites. You can instantiate Drupal variables, Drupal modules, Drupal themes, very, very simply, very, very easily, just like any other resource. You can say, I want the module date to be an 8. I want the module date to be at version 7, 2x, whatever. And you can use the exact same language you use with any other resource. So you can put this in a manifest. You can put this right inside of a manifest, and you can give one of your coworkers this manifest, and you say, this is the development environment that we are using. And you won't have any incompatibilities. You won't have anybody working on one version, and you won't have anybody running out of memory because they tried to fill with the PHP API. Everybody will be on the same boat, and you don't have any of that friction that comes from debugging these little one-off things over and over and over again. So to grab the module, you can either go to the website, forge.publiclabs.com, slash my username, slash my module, or you can use the pub module tool, which is installed from open source right out of the box. Pub module search Drupal, it'll give you a couple of modules. This one here, made for 2K Drupal, is my module that I'm speaking about. You can install it, single command, it will download all of the dependencies and install them for you. Apache and MySQL to optionally manage basically the full stack. Now what it looks like, very, very simple. This is the full description of a machine running Drupal with a default site and a subsite and a module installed instantiate. What does this mean? We have a node. This node is going to include the Apache class, which makes sure that Apache is installed, makes sure that all of the modules are available. It will include the MySQL class, which does the same thing for MySQL, makes sure that MySQL is installed and ready to use. It will make sure that you have a host record in your empty hosts or the equivalent on your platform. And the reason for that is that Apache doesn't really like to spin up a V host if it doesn't have, if it can't look it up. And I'm a name here is namespaced, so that you can install a module for any given site. We have the site name, the scope operator, and then the module name. If you want to install for the default site, you can use default for the site name, or you can simply omit it and it will default to the default site. My module does not manage the virtual hosts and database by default. That's not the public way of doing it. That kind of breaks abstraction just a little bit, but it seemed like most people are interested in having some kind of all-in-one. So I put the option in there. So if you want to allow it to manage your virtual host in your database, you can choose to do so. There are a couple of patches there. If you tell it to manage its own database, you tell another site to spin up and manage this database, unless you override the database user and the database password and all of that, it will conflict because you can only have one instance of any given resource. So there are very good reasons for you to manage your own if you want to share anything. Let us see it in action. I have a virtual machine that I've got spun up here. This is the same virtual machine that we use in our training. It is default CentOS. There's not really anything to it other than the fact that it has a Puppet Labs, Puppet Enterprise installer sitting on it ready to go. And it also has upstream Yum repositories turned off and it's got some stuff cached. So this is a default CentOS machine with nothing done to it. I've been fiddling with it, so just to make sure that it's back in its state, I'll show you right here. I'm going to remove, make sure that Apache is removed, that MySQL is removed, Drupal is removed, etc. And then, Puppet Agent-T. This is going to kick off the Puppet run. It's going to talk to the Puppet master, and it's going to spend a little bit of time downloading and installing stuff. Now, the network here is not the best. There are a whole bunch of people using it, so this is probably going to take about 90 seconds to get everything downloaded. So in the meantime, I'm just going to bore you with some more stories on what we can do. The Puppet master is running on a separate machine. I did that simply so that I could blow this machine away without worrying about having to spin up another master. Give me one second, and I will SSH into the master. Sorry, I should have had that set up before. See that this configuration is basically a cut and paste of what I had on that slide. So we're going to install Apache and MySQL. We're going to make sure that there's a host entry, and then we're going to make sure that Drupal is installed, that there's a site enabled, and that there's a plugin. See a whole bunch of stuff here happening. See that it's got everything downloaded, so now it's installing packages, it is putting things in place, it is building out all of the sites, and it's calling out to Drupal. just started up the Apache web server. There is the new site. So now, I'm going to show you some of the other things that it will do. Power resource, Drupal. This will go through and it will list all of the modules we have enabled. We have the default the modules that are in the default site, and we have modules that are in the site that I just put up. It's got all of them listed. Can also go through, let's see, what was the one that we just installed? Token. It will give you information about a single specific instance. So the token module is enabled for this site. And it's at version 7x15, and it's got the label the package and all that that you see. Now it's gone. I'm going to go back to the site here. Line. Give it a moment to run. There it is. So now we can just fully describe our Drupal instance, including all of our subsites, with a simple manifest. This includes themes, this includes modules, this includes variables. So the question is, what happens about module updates? What happens when the agent runs and there is an update to a module? Currently, the way that I have it designed is just like with packages in Puppet. If you say that you want a package to be installed, it will be installed and it doesn't care what version it is. If you want a specific version to be installed, it will install a specific version. The Puppet package provider also has a special keyword of ensure latest, which means it will update. I have not added that to the module right now. So you can ensure a specific version, but you can say ensure latest and have it automatically go out and update it every single time it runs. The reason I didn't do that is because I haven't thought of a very good way of doing it right now, because when Drush checks for updates, it'll call out each time, and it's not exactly the fastest. And I didn't want it to be—I didn't want it to double or triple the execution time. So, if you have suggestions on how I can do that in a quick way, then I would be all ears. In the meantime, just ensure a specific version if you want that. So the things that I talked about, pretty simple, is just how Puppet works. The efficient workflow of describing what you want, letting Puppet figure out how to make it work, and then you go do something that actually provides value for the company. We talked about the Puppet language itself, and I told you about the links that you should bookmark, where you should go to find documentation, me how to download it when I want it. And that's a pretty big business card. That's actually a photograph of my business card. That's probably the first one I've ever done. So, if you are interested, I saw several people taking photographs. If you go to smart.health, you can actually download a PDF of the talk. There's not really a whole lot to it, I bet, but I expect most of it to be in questions. Let me get the IP address of my machine and I'll put it up there. Okay.
If you can read that, that's 10.
10.141.12.31/ port 9090/download. Okay. Now I expect that we will have some questions here. So who wants to start off? Who wants to go first? Do you have to run it as root or sim? The Puppet Master can run as any user. It is typically run as like an HTTP user because it's backed by the Apache web server. The Puppet Agent should be run as root if you want to do any root-level things, such as installing packages. So depending on what you're doing, you can get away with running it as a non-root user, but you will have to keep those limitations in mind. The Puppet Master is like a web service. It runs on a machine that compiles a catalog. The catalog is basically the object representation, the compiled version of the configuration state you can find. The agent requests that catalog and then applies that catalog. So the agent runs on every single node, and the master runs on just one Puppet Master. You can also run it in standalone mode and just apply manifest directly. Or you can run a Puppet Master and a Puppet Agent on a single node. There are several different execution models for Puppet. This one is just kind of the default, most common. And if you walk through the tutorial, you'll see all of these described in great length on how to go about doing that.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I was wondering if you could configure the modules that you require, like in the Puppet list.
Yes, you certainly can. Matter of fact, I can show you an example of what it does. Let me get on the right tab there. So in order to instantiate a MySQL database, you would do something like this, MySQL DB, you know, pass in parameters of what you want this to look like. So, okay, if you want to configure a vhost, there it is. If you want to configure a vhost, you would call out the Apache vhost type, and you just pass in parameters like that. So, if you want to configure Apache itself, if you want to pass in parameters to the actual Apache class, you can do something very similar to this. There's a huge laundry list of different parameters that will accept. Same with MySQL, you can run it on a non-standard port. You can have you can set a specific database root user, etc. Password for the root user, those kind of things. But yes, configuring all of the resources in Puppet look basically the same, like this. It's just a matter of figuring out which parameters that they accept. Yes.
Two quick questions. The first was when you run the Puppet command to enable and disable the module, is it actually using Drush to do that?
Like it is most certainly using Drush. I can even show you what it looks like, although I don't expect it to be very understandable. written in the public language that is very, very easy, very, very simple to read, very simple to use. The actual providers that do something, those are written in Ruby, and some of them can get to be a little bit less than comprehensible. But what this does is it runs Grub site alias to list all the sites you have available. And then for each one of those sites, it will then run pm list to grab all of the parameters of the different of the modules that are installed. And then it just uses a bunch of code here to instantiate records in Puppet's model. In order to install and uninstall, it will run Grudge PM enable and disable, Grudge PM download, etc. So yes, I use Grudge quite heavily. It's a very, very neat tool.
Okay. And then the second question was, if you had, for the example you showed, token, you said ensure enabled, but then you went and disabled it. In that example, the next time the agent ran, would token get re-enabled because you said in the manifest that it should be enabled?
Yes.
Okay.
It will. I have a small file that I need to get rid of in my module. Yes, it will. It will definitely do that. It will make sure that everything is in the state that it has been defined. Does not update the Puppet Master. I updated I edited the what was on the machine. Oh, I renamed it, didn't I? Yeah. There we go. Absent. Alright, so now the Puppet Agent run will do what we expect. Because I just disabled it, and now I'm going to run Puppet Agent again. And Puppet is going to say, okay, your manifest says this module needs to be enabled. It's not enabled, so we're going to do that.
Great, thank you.
You bet.
This is a question more about Puppet in general. Does Puppet provide any utilities that allow you to build a manifest from existing service configuration? So I want to Puppetify a server farm that I've built, but I don't want to have to build the manifest by hand. Can I just say, hey, build me a manifest from Apache and manifest?
That's it. Are certain ways that you can inspect your system and get Puppet code back, but there's not really a way of like taking a snapshot, because how do you say that I care about the package Apache but I don't care about the package Groff, for example, right? So getting to that point where we can actually take a snapshot and make a reasonable manifest out of it, nobody's really figured out how to do that yet. There are some tools out there. Blueprint is a tool that can generate a Puppet manifest to do something similar to what you're talking about. But you kind of have to babysit a little bit, and it makes pretty terrible manifests because it doesn't have any innate understanding of what goes of what things mean of context, right? So it can't really do any. There's no way that it could do better yet. What you can do. If I run Puppet resource and I tell it a certain type that I'm interested in, it will give me Puppet code back that is the exact representation of the host record file.
Okay. Does that work for any object or any resource?
Yep. It'll work for any type that has a finite number. So for the exact type, which is basically run a command, there's not a finite list of all the commands that can exist. But for users, there's a finite list of users that exist on the machine. So anything that has a finite list, it will definitely work.
How is your module taking care of? Well, is this module handling installation configuration in PHP?
No. It is not. It's not really the place of this module that kind of breaks the coupling there. It's overly coupled. But no, it's just expecting PHP to be installed. If what you would do is say download a
destroy a virtual machine and spin up a new one. I get like duplicate certificate errors or something like that. Do you have any advice for people that are using Vagrant and using Puppet and MyStrategy kind of setup?
There are two things that you can do. Kind of depends on the context of what exactly you're getting at. If you're using Vagrant to manage a group of machines and that's all they're going to do, and they're all going to be classified the same way, just use the default node. This is the default node up here. It's basically used if nothing else matches. You put whatever you want in there. The other thing that you can do is use a regular expression as a node. So you can say everything, in this case, everything that matches the regular expression of classroom something dot dynamic dot blah blah blah. So yeah, we'll get this configuration.
Yeah, that's the latter is what I'm using to do that. I think my question was more like, so if I spin up a Vagrant box and I destroy it, when I spin up a new Vagrant box, I have to, like, I'm forced to assign a new node. So, you know, as I'm doing auto assigning start on local or whatever, and then I'm using a regular expression, granted it's not PP, but I'm getting like cert errors, and it's so my hacky way around that is to just like assign a random string to the like node name, because otherwise it complains that like it doesn't want to give me a certificate when I connect to the master.
That's kind of the common thing to do, because then it allows you to have unique nodes if you care about them.
Yeah.
And then you can have multiple ones come up and address them individually, revoke them individually, and all that. If you don't, you can also do something like share a node or share a certificate. So you can pre-create certificates and just copy them into place. So as long as the node, or as long as the certificate and the actual cert name match. You know how to change the cert name of a node?
Yeah, I'm not going to clean it from the master.
So in the agent, we have a cert name right here.
Okay.
So if my cert name said generic.pubdlabs.vm, I could just copy in all of the certificates that, like the certificates that matched that. And it will just get the generic node pattern and assign to PP.
Okay.
So that's another alternative.
Cool. Awesome. Thanks.
You bet. If you're interested in something more advanced, like automation to call back to the Puppet Master to assign and revoke and all that, talk to me afterwards and I'll show you how the REST API works.
Quick couple of comments and a few questions. We'll start with the small ones. About getting Drush to do updates without calling to Drupal.org every time. I think that Drupal stores a cache of those update XML files set for Drupal.org. So it probably wouldn't be difficult to patch Drush to use the cached update XML files.
That's an interesting idea.
But I'm not sure if that would have worked the way you needed to. But just
that would be something that I would want to submit back upstream, because I don't really want to manage my own fork but that's a really good idea. They may be doing that already. I don't know. I'll have to run some testing. I made the assumption that that's how it worked, and I didn't even try it.
Oh, okay. So I would be surprised if Drush wasn't using that cache already.
Okay. I'll
test that.
Thank you.
So I'm just trying to understand how you implemented this a bit more. Drush is managed by the Drupal class, is that correct?
It is managed by the Drupal class in a sense. Okay, there we go. So I have a second class, Drupal Drush, that actually manages Drupal itself, but my Drupal class calls out to this class. So yes, it is, and if for some reason somebody wanted a Drupal site without Rush, I could probably put in an option that says include Rush or not.
So when you include Drupal or define a Drupal class, that's what installs Rush.
Yeah.
Is Drush, from the point of view of Puppet, is Drush just a provider like an edge?
Yes, that is exactly what it does. So this means that the module type and the variable type and the theme type, etc., are not actually available for use until Drush, the class Drupal Drush, has been included. But I have a dependency to make sure that Drush gets included on the machine before any of the other resources get evaluated.
For a site that needed specific Apache modules, for example, I manage a site that requires module, would that mean I would have to manage the vhost on my own manifest, or can that be passed through the Drupal class?
You can manage just a very small subsection of things that the Apache vhost can accept. Basically, you can pass through like options, like follow some link, et cetera, et cetera. So what you would want to do is manage the vhost yourself. But the Apache class that I'm using from Puppet Labs is very, very good at that. You can include the Apache. There is a resource type of Apache module. So you can say include Apache module, BitTorrent or whatever. And it will do all the legwork to make that happen.
Okay. My last question for now is about media. Drush, are you familiar with Drush Make?
Drush Make?
Yeah.
I am familiar with it enough that I use it a few times and I know how it works.
Okay. So you've probably seen that Drush Make files are fairly similar conceptually to Puppet Manifest, but not nearly as comprehensive.
Right. So Drush Make will let you make a make file that says, once Apache is installed, once MySQL is installed, once PHP is configured, all this, then I can use Drush Make to build this Drupal instance. So it's kind of the same concept, except I'm taking that and I'm expanding that out and I'm saying, I'm not going to manage just Drupal, I'm going to manage your entire server, the entire virtual machine.
So can your Drupal module be used for sites that manage the contra module dependencies via a make file that don't want to keep that in a public manifest? Is it a secret layer? It can't.
At this point, no. I wasn't sure if there was going to be a large market for that. I wasn't sure if there was going to be interest in doing that. I would be quite happy to accept a pull request for that, or when I get time to add that feature, it's on the list of things that I should probably do.
I suspect that's something that a lot of people would want, and they would certainly need that for a project. It might be something you're working on because it's a bit of a rollout.
It seems like that would be a pretty reasonable thing to do, just pass through an option to say, instantiate this site or instantiate a Drupal class and pass through a make file.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. And actually, I just got one more since it was could this be used to manage a server that in a zero touch configuration, so no one can SSH into that server?
Yes.
And what would the deploy process be? Would it integrate with Git or something to pull in the custom code parts from website?
So this is what we call the bootstrap problem, because the first thing that you need to do is get the Puppet agent on the node. But as soon as you get the agent on that particular machine, we can do anything. So if you make your provisioning process in such a way that you put an agent on the node, then we can configure it in any way after that. So you can do that with either a golden image, or you can do that by enabling SSH to begin with, SSH in, install the agent, and then remove SSH. It's kind of up to you how you decide. There are many, many ways that people have come up with of doing that bootstrap. But that really is the only kind of difficult thing to do.
Yeah, it's not so much interested in the bootstrap, but how would updates to the custom code for that website then be deployed in a zero-touch environment that was using this?
Updates to, like, Puppet?
To the Drupal website.
Right, so
some of the files for the Drupal website would be custom code typically for a site that's using Puppet.
You could do just use the Apache push shows app. So anything that gets put into the module gets automatically synced out to the agent. So the if I were to go in and update my module provider, that would automatically get synced out to all of my agents. And so they always have the current code as far as what it does. Is if I were to add the feature of big files, all of my nodes would just kind of inherit that without me having to do anything to it. And if you want to update system packages, you simply edit your manifest, update the increment version of the manifest, the version of the package, or say you want the latest version or something like that.
Like something.
Sure.
Would it be possible to have some kind of personal program to provide the password for the website instead of having it in plain text?
You say that again?
For a module, you've got the password for the website. Would it be possible to have it providing from somewhere else?
The database password or the admin password?
The admin password for the website.
Okay.
Is it common? Is it not?
So there are two ways for it to work. If you pass in an admin password, it will use that. If you do not pass in an admin password, it will generate one for you. And as it runs, when it's done, the last thing that it does is echo out your password. I don't remember exactly where I put it, but it will echo out the admin password into the logs once it's created. The admin user.
One last question. Do you have any roadmap for your module?
I do not yet, but it is up on GitHub, and feel free to file a feature request or anything.
Thank you.
You can find the GitHub link directly from the forge, by the way. It's a project URL up at the top.
Hi, thanks for the talk. A couple of things. So I store services like Solr or Memcache would be managed in a separate module.
Yes.
So it would just be included in the site configuration next to the Drupal configuration.
Yes. So what you would want to do is in your node definition, you would include Memcache, Solr, whatever, and pass any configuration to that. And then say this means you're running Apache on a non-standard port, then you would simply tell either the Apache class or the Google class that you want your vehicles running on that same port.
And so for things like Solr core name, that would depend on if the Solr module for Puppet is able to configure that.
Yep.
Okay. And then a couple things with Drush. Drush 6 has a thing called output formats where you can specify it to output in a certain way, like an init button or things like that. I found that incredibly useful. And some Perl scripts that I've been working with to do basically
nasty regex is up there.
Yeah.
So I tried getting the JSON export to work, and it did not work properly for modules. So that's why, not modules, for for variables. It didn't work properly for variables. So that's why I wrote the regexes to do that, to just export it in plain text and then jump to it. I expect that will be fixed before long.
Yeah, I found that the JSON is a little bit tricky. Other formats have been really nice for module lists and things like that. And also, the Drush project has a pair repository for Drush, so you could pull from there.
But that would be a lot better than WGET.
Yeah, but the version strings are different than 7.x-6.0. I think it's 6.0.0 for Drush 6. So,
I will look into those. Thank you.
Hopefully this was a basic question, but I only recently discovered Puppet and Vagrant for a second in the development environment, and I'm not a Ruby guy, so I was trying to find some sort of boilerplate setup or whatever. So I have it mostly working, but I have an issue with file permissions right now, and I'm using an NFS mount to do that. For performance reasons, that was a recommendation. And the documentation on this is a little bit terse. So, is issue or a vagrant issue? How is that supposed to be done?
Where are you getting the permission errors? So you have an NFS mount from the vagrant host back from the vagrant machine back to your host machine?
Exactly.
Okay, so NFS is a little bit tricky as far as permissions go. It manages permissions in kind of a backwards way, like it maps them to UID. So the UIDs need to match up. There are ways that you can do that. The simplest way is to just ensure that the UIDs match, so that user XYZ on this machine has a UID of 1021, and on this machine also has a UID of 1021. So that's the key, is getting the UIDs to match up. If you have like other permission errors, like root can't read a file or something, then I expect you getting more protocol error. I have found that NFS version 4 is actually not quite as reliable as version 3. So I have often ended up forcing version 3 on NFS mounts. And you do that with just putting a NFS, let's see what's the magic option, NFS V3. I think in your FS tab. So you'll find that documentation on how to do that on Google. It's fairly simple to do.
Unwrapping the UIDs.
What's that?
Unwrapping the UIDs.
Yeah, just make sure that the UIDs match up, that they're the same, and try forcing it to NFS version 3.
Okay. Thank you.
You match up. Let's see. What's that? My IP address is, I have to pick ETH1. Oh, come on. Max, why must it be different? What's that? Sure. Yes, I will definitely do that. 10.141.12.31. So if you can read that, that's my IP address 10.141.12.31 port 9090/download. And I think they're coming in to kick me off the stage, so I will close it up. Feel free to drop me a line, drop me an email, and I can answer any other questions that you might have. And thanks for coming.